Hey, welcome to my show, my little humble corner of the world. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for listening, downloading, all that fun stuff. I usually have musical guests on here most of the time. That's just the way things have kind of shaken up. But I've had other types of artists on here, photographers, writers, and especially more recently, I had a great writer on named Cameron McWhorter who wrote an amazing book. Check out that episode on talesfromthecorners.com or look up TFTC with Bob Niebel. That is a long Niebel. Check that out wherever you get those podcasts. I'm available everywhere. I'm pretty sure it took a lot for me to get to Apple Music, Apple Podcasts, not music, Apple Podcasts. Took a little bit, a little trickery on the nets there. I figured it out. Just like a whole bunch of other things I figured out here. It has just been so fun. I believe I'm getting to the fourth year here doing this. I'm not really one to get nostalgic and figure out how many episodes I've done, although it is on the counter somewhere with my provider. Anywho, this is a great show today, and we're nest. Oh wow, Valentine's Day! I gotta get honey something here. Honey, people really love to get into. A lot of people love you either love it or loathe it, right? Or I guess there are very few who are indifferent. But Valentine's Day, wow, it's upon us again. It just kind of creeps up on us. Like right when the new year starts, actually, like pretty much right after Christmas. Like, what? Now we're into that, the next holiday. Guess what? I just went, and I don't go very often. We went to the Cracker Barrel, and they always seem to be about three seasons ahead. And it's like, oh my God, Valentine's already, like right, like even before Christmas. And oh, you're going to Walmart? Oh my gosh, it's like we're just getting like ice storms as we're, I mean, not here, but like across the country. We're in winter time and they already got the spring stuff out there. I know you gotta think ahead in retail, but they got that stuff out on the floor. And I worked in retail many, many moons ago. I mean, we stayed ahead maybe by a season, but like these days, it's like, I don't know, two, three seasons ahead. Because I can remember back even in that very, very hot summer, which we get here in the Southeast, which I've been here many moons and it still bothers me. But anywho, it's like, you're in August and they've got like Halloween stuff out. It's like, I can't even think of Halloween. It's stifling hot out here. Anyway, it is what it is. Valentine's Day is coming up upon us today. I have a really great guest. He is from Tennessee. He's in the Nashville area. Dave Coleman of a group called the Coleman, to take off on his name. And they do great music, a lot of country influence, but a lot of rock and pop as well in their repertoire. They have a new album that's coming out in late March. I am releasing this on the heels of the first single that came from that album called Everett. And it is a great release. Listen to it. It is just absolutely fantastic. Get out there and get it wherever you get music. Pre-order it right now. I am releasing this before the release of that wonderful album called Everett from the Coleman. So without further ado, enjoy our lovely conversation. What a great guy. I had a great time speaking with Dave Coleman of the Coleman. Hey, good morning. How you doing?
Pretty good, man. How are you?
Good, good. You're up in Nashville?
Just we're frozen up here in the middle of a little weird ice age, so.
Yeah, it happens much more up there. I'm down here in Atlanta, and when it happens here, we really don't know what to do. I've been here many moons, and it's just always an issue. I don't know how bad it could get in Nashville. You get a little bit more being a little bit more north of here.
I guess it's been nuts. We've been kind of held up at the house, and we've had a. It's been we made the most of it. We were going to go up to Roan Mountain State Park and get a cabin, my wife and I, and but we're not going to make it. We got to reschedule. So.
Yeah, it's always dicey in these months. Yeah, anytime you plan anything, it's like it gets really, really, really dicey. It's like, I don't know, is it gonna, it could be beautiful one weekend and then some other weekend, it's just this crazy, crazy snowstorm and ice and all of that. So obviously you have power, which is a good thing 'cause
Yeah, we really lucked out with all that. We Everything's been great here at the house. Really grateful for like a the we bought this home about 15 year close to 15 years ago and remodeled it. And back when you could get a starter home in Nashville, you know, and not so much anymore. But yeah, we love this place. My studio for making music is here, and so my commute's great. I don't have to get outside very much. And when it gets bad like this, so we're really really lucky to have this place. So.
Yeah, and doing what you do, you could do it straight from there. It's not like the old days you had to truck down to a studio and do most of your work there. You could do so much at home.
Yeah. Oh man, it's been great. Yeah. It's great to get out of the house every now and then. The cabin fever thing does set in, you know, whether it's traveling and playing with a band or gigs or sessions at different places, but it's so great to have it right here. So, I noticed you're a runner, right?
Yes,
That's
yes. Oh,
great,
you've
man.
done your research.
Well, you know, but I'm a big fan of running. It's been like a great sort of mental health, like, you know, thing for me through the years to keep me sane. And but about, I guess it's March 2 years ago, I slipped and broke my ankle on the ice.
I
And I was
always worry
going,
about injury.
well, I was going to the doctor. I was on my way walking across a parking lot to go to a doctor, and it had iced over that morning. And I'm not a morning person. I got to get up and get going, get my coffee. So I went straight there, slipped on the ice, broke my ankle, and so I never want to do that again. So my wife got me these amazing, they're like these Amazon crampons, which are like sort of cleats that you put around your shoes. It's incredible. These are new gadgets and tools to use, but they're
I'll
hilarious
look that
looking.
up.
Oh man, they're I don't know if you can see this. Yeah.
Good. We need the visuals here because we do put this on YouTube. Okay.
Yeah, check it out. Just like little buy them at home and put them on your feet. So, safety first, folks.
Snow chains for the feet, there, as
Exactly.
we heard there.
Exactly.
That's awesome. As we record this, your new single Black Cat is out.
Yeah.
It's
Oh man.
exciting. I love
Yeah.
that song. That's a great song. And you have a video to it. You know, I grew up making, if you've done your looked at my bio, I grew up making Super 8 mm films. It kind of
Yeah.
became a thing for me. I love that.
Well,
I so appreciate that. Your video has a lot of that.
yeah, I started using I mean it's all, modern technology. I wish I had had an older camera that could access that kind of stuff. Being able to develop or get films like that made and sync audio and video, which is like, if going down the rabbit hole of sort of video editing, which you know all
Which I
about,
do, yes.
it's a challenge, but I find a lot of great parallels between making music and video editing, making it rhythmic, creating an arc and storytelling with the visuals that you get, even if they're simple, you can really, and oh, so here's a, maybe you've had this at some point. I did the Black Cat video, filmed that and edited that together. And I was doing another one the other day, and this is what happened. I had some old footage that I thought I had it in the can. Great footage, really cool ambient stuff. And I started to put it together for the song, editing it together rhythmically, hours and hours deep into this project. And I get it to a stage where I'm like, I'm gonna print this and see if it see how it holds up. And it was terrible.
That's I had that's the thing about film development too. Well, even you get
Well,
that with video too. It's like if you shoot something even on digital and you don't have like a monitor nearby, I know it's really hard to focus with the HD camera. So you can come back with something that's a little out of focus and it's like, ah, my God, I had the perfect shot. And this thing is like you can sharpen that in editing, but oh, that's so frustrating.
well, just that, I was heartbroken at the time. I thought, oh man, this video, I spent so much time working with my band trying to get this video together. But it was a good, humbler moment where I, just let the creative process flow, see it through, and you're not always going to win. If you win, it'd be easy, and
Yeah.
everybody could just, throw it out there and make it happen. But, it was a great humbling moment. And again, like I'm with what I do with video stuff for myself or artists like Tim Carroll or John Bird, I've done some video work for. I try and stick with a very simple medium and concept of how I do things, and so I kind of stick within my lane, and I'm always really, really, I have just enough knowledge to be envious and really excited about other people's videography of when they really pull it off and do something great.
So, I didn't really know about so much your backstory. Did you grow up in Tennessee? And you were interested in the nature in Tennessee and wanting to be a park ranger?
So my mom was a park ranger for 23 years at a little park called Big South Fork up on the Cumberland Plateau. And it's a really rural pocket of the Cumberland Mountain, or it's the Cumberland Plateau essentially. And there's a beautiful park up there called Big South Fork. And it's was founded in the 70s. And it's a big horse equestrian park, lots of, but it's really seldom visited. You get the Smokies, which is the most visited of all the national parks. Well, that's the east side, but just very, very similar is all these sandstone bluffs and cliffs and arches up on the plateau, and it's beautiful. And I loved growing up there. It was very Andy Griffith kind of growing up in a little town called Jamestown, and
Oh, that's
we had
cool.
our little Presbyterian church and my little elementary school. And living in Nashville, there's all these school choices for kids and folks that have kids, and everybody has elementary and middle school, and that wasn't a thing for us. We went kindergarten through eight with the same kids, and then high school with the same kids. But it was a great place to grow up and live. And I wanted to be a park ranger, but I had been playing music, and it drew me in, and there's that all the sort of mafia lingo from movies where there's like the I try and get out, but they pull me back in, that kind of thing. I could never stop music. I'm kind of a what people joke around about lifers and a very blue collar. I've had this band for coming up on 25 years, so that luck of having that family has kept it going all these years too.
Yeah, how did the band come about? I mean, obviously you started music very early and got the excitement for that. I
Oh
mean,
man, yeah.
yeah.
Well, we I in college, I started writing songs, and essentially met a fiddle player, wonderful guy named Kevin Arrowsmith, who was in the band early, and he knew a drummer in Murfreesboro and the bass player, the original bass player in the band, I had grown up with since I was a kid. We were neighbors. I guess knew each other since, well, maybe age 4 or 5, lived on the same block, and a guy named Jason Hitchcock, wonderful guy. And but we grew up playing music together. We were just kids playing around, and it was, we weren't particularly good at sports, so we found a path to hang out and do stuff. And so Hitch was in the band for many years. So but the drummer Dave Ray was there since the very beginning, and but we started playing down at MTSU, the school that they were going to. I was going to Belmont University in Nashville, Tennessee, a Presbyterian at a Baptist, which is a college, which is hilarious. But we started the band. We started jamming and started doing just local gigs. And I had a batch of about maybe 10 songs. And like I said, we were originally a five piece. There was Kevin fiddle, Jason Hitchcock playing bass, Dave playing drums, and a wonderful college friend and incredible musician named Justin Shipper, who's now a pedal steel ace session guy here in town. But Justin was in the band, and I was roommates with Justin for many years in college. And it was just a hot band. We were like a bunch of kids, really still learning our instruments. And I was in that great period of writing where you're fearless and kind of naive. So you got some really good, unique things, and some real clunkers too, but it was exciting. And so we started gigging all the time, playing here in Nashville at a place called Windows in the Cumberland and another place called the Flying Saucer. that there's a few of those around. But at the time, it was a sweet little gig. We would do every Tuesday night, and I'd have some buddies come and open up who were older guys that were really experienced, like sort of my heroes in town. They would come and do an opening set, and then our band would play. And yeah, so it's weird. Just it's a chain of events that unfolds in your life. Like, how did I get here? Well, there's a bunch of links that kind of line up, and here you are. I don't know. So,
Like that Talking Head song, "How Did I Get Into This Place?" It's like,
oh, yeah.
what? It's so true. And it's so true about life as well. So you've probably seen all the changes in Nashville as it has exploded. You were talking earlier about, like, yeah, expenses change too. It becomes
Yeah.
more pricey. It happened here in Atlanta, especially with the hip hop industry and the film industry here. So in Nashville, it's, Music City in itself. So I'm
Yeah.
sure, yeah, that's a place that's just exploded.
Yeah, so my wife works for the Chamber of Commerce, the Nashville Area Chamber of Commerce. So I always joke around with her that, like, hey, you're doing too good at your job. Like this is really, over the top these days. But she's also really taught me to embrace, like, the city's changing, and growth is better than decline. And it's either
Sure.
or. There's no, like, maintain, like that sweet nostalgic moment of your favorite version of that day or that place. So she's taught me a lot about that. And but I still there's so much of what I loved 20 years ago. It's still in Nashville. Things do fade away, but I mean, I don't want to be nostalgic too much. This sounds like pure vanity, but it has a point. I have a song of the band's that has a line in it that says, "Nostalgia is a waste like no other," and not that I had any great epiphany there. It's been said probably a million different ways, but I want to try and enjoy where I'm at and what I'm doing now.
Oh, sure. Yeah, you absolutely have to do that. Totally. So it's been a while since your previous release. This has been about 8 years now,
Yeah,
and
so
having this new album.
it's crazy. It's not that I've been, like, retired or anything like that, or the band's not been playing. We've still been working a bunch and recording, but we made this record pre-pandemic, and we were wrapping it up around the time of the pandemic, but didn't feel like it was a good time to release. And so much of my day is recording other bands and helping other artists make their records. I kind of transitioned into doing that, just kind of a utilitarian path. Like I in my illustrious rock and roll and country music career, I've worked in a coffee shop many years to support to support the bills and all that stuff. But I had this skill set of recording and playing guitar that I essentially just let that be my job. And like I said, I don't really know how it happened. It kind of just happened and unfolded. In like I said, all that great community here in Nashville, those people that I loved 20 years ago, that community that I was a part of has made that happen because they trusted me to help make their records and record and be a part of their band, either live and then maybe when it time to came to record a record, they'd trust me to start it and see it through. So I kind of took over that role as being a sort of a day-to-day instrumentalist and producer here in town. And but the band, it's been a little while. Like I said, we did a record that I'm really proud of called Push to the Side back in 2016. And that was a each record kind of has a different shift in tone and what Dave and now the bass player is a wonderful guy named Paul Slovka, who I've known for 25 years. He joined the band whenever Jason Hitchcock left back in around 2011. So Paul's been in the band longer than Hitch was now, just about. And but we did that record Push to the Side, and it was very acoustic, sort of acoustic based, but lots of great, like, little subtle colors here and there from different instruments. I really got into singing in a lower register, which was really fun. But I love that record, and Man, we had a lot of good times getting around and playing that one. But this most recent record we did featured really the core three-piece band, where we're tracking together here in the studio. And then conceptually, the only really, I wanted to keep it really simple, but the only thing I really added to it was an old church piano I bought for the studio. This old Everett piano, which is a defunct company. They're no longer around. We could get the trademark right now on it, I think, because it,
It's been around a
long
long time. Yeah. It's
gone.
like a 1950s uprights and beautiful
It's
piano.
got a sort of sound to it. And like I said about push to the side, little subtle additions. I didn't want like a Jerry Lee Lewis record or like,
Right.
or anything like that. But I wanted just a little bit of accent as a guitar player and a singer. Well, de facto singer. I never really wanted to be a singer either, but I kind
Funny.
of had to do it. No one else was going to sing the song.
Yeah, you're gonna do, Jim Morrison, I think, was thrust into it, and didn't he address the audience with his back? It was like, I could see that feeling though, like, oh, yeah, tag your ads.
Yeah, the deepest fear of it and excitement of an introvert is to get on stage, I think,
Sure.
I'll get up there for a little bit and then I'll get off. I'll just be a bit. But the
Cool.
piano, we started adding the piano, and I played a little bit. My friend Jen Gunderman, who's a wonderful keyboard player in town, I called her in. She had played on a quite a few Coleman projects, records through the years, and then a wonderful musician, a guy named Lane Keflin, who is actually a sort of a side hustle of his is tuning the piano.
And you need
Tuning
those
pianos
guys.
all over Nashville. So he came in
Wow.
and as he was tuning, I was like, "Hey, can you play this part?" And he knocked it out real quick. But that he actually played on Black Cat. So the piano tuner Lane Keffling is rocking the piano. So
That's cool. And Jen worked with Sheryl Crow on what specific projects, just stuff that she'd been doing up in Nashville.
the most recent couple records that she's done, I can't think of the names of the offhand, but she's been part of that road band.
Yeah, yeah.
It's crazy to think that Sheryl Crow is a legacy act now,
I
who's like,
know.
I didn't feel like, oh, like I remember that Tuesday Night Music Club coming out, and it was the coolest thing, and the Globe Sessions is incredible. So
Yeah.
her and her husband Oddly Freed are now part of that road band, and it's just an incredible sounding band. And Jen has brought that band down here to record a while back for a little side project she was doing for Vanderbilt University. She's also a teacher at Vanderbilt University. She teaches the history of rock and roll.
Well, I once took a class like that many
Yeah.
months ago. I was at Ohio University and
Oh,
I
yeah.
took that. And it was wonderful. The guy passed away years ago, but one of my it was kind of an assignment to review a rock show. They had Stevie Ray Vaughan come down with the Fabulous Thunderbirds.
Oh, man, no way.
Yeah, I was like, what? It was incredible. Yeah, it wasn't like a huge name. This was early 1986 that we're going on.
Too
38
cool.
years. Like,
Well,
oh my gosh.
that's pretty legendary. It's funny you mentioned the Thunderbirds. So we play down in Key West a lot. We travel down there and
Cool.
play, and all these about 18 years we started going down there years ago with a couple members of the band, the Mavericks. The original drummer and bass player, Paul Deacon and Robert Reynolds, would go down there, and sometimes they'd ask other people to come down and put together a band. And so started going down there to play, brought the Colemans down there, and on the jukebox at one of our favorite late night bars down there, I heard a record by the Fabulous Thunderbirds.
Oh.
Man, it just killed me. It was one of those moments where every now and then you hear something that just you connect with and you're like, that's my music. And for me, like even, recording a lot and working with different people, like every now and
Yeah.
then I get that little kid feeling of hearing something and that blowing your mind. And I happened to hear this Fabulous Thunderbirds record, down there in Florida, and that they've been a big influence on me. And just recently, with a friend of mine, I got a chance to play guitar for an artist opening for them here in town. the Fabulous Thunderbirds, and man, still rocking, still like harmonica playing, like soul singing, everything's in the original key, just incredible. So, well, big
Wow.
fan of those guys.
These many years later, yeah. Wow. I can never forget that. But this great new album is coming out in late March as we speak. You got your first single, Black Cat, out, which has like this really great T-Rex vibe to it. And it really does. It really captures that. Yeah. So check that out.
Yeah, we like I said, we jump we've we stylistically we've sort of, I say jumped around, but it's within sort of our strengths of what we do, I hope. But this record is really three piece focused, and like you said, we leaned into the T-Rex thing a little bit, and I'm a big fan of Tony Joe White. I have like a one, I have like a 2-octave range, you know, like singing kind of low. So kind of leaning into to that low voice thing, with the band after all these years, you know, you've got different stages. The first record that we did was back in like, I guess, 2004, the first official record. And I listened back and my voice was so high and I had a little bit of more of a country twang when I sang, you know, I kind of put on like a, like sort of
Like
a,
that.
a metaphorical, like, you know, country suit when I sang a little bit.
Yeah. I could feel that through the
Yeah,
whole
through
release.
the years, I've kind of chilled out and just
Yeah.
sang like myself and sort of found my voice, and really proud of this thing. And Dave Ray, the drummer in the band, sings such great harmonies on the record too. He's got such a more powerful voice. And anytime we play live, I use, if there's a house sound engineer, I have to tell him, like, I sing kind of quiet, and the drummer, you don't even need to use a mic. He's
That's
so
a
loud.
feat, really.
Yeah, he's but he man, so happy that Dave got a chance to really shine singing on the record. So
It's amazing that a drummer can sing at the same time. You've got to have a special kind of mind.
I
Wow, you got to
know.
practice a lot to drum and to sing. Don Henley, I watch. I'm like, how do you do that? It's
Yeah.
just magic.
Well, for like recording records and working with different singers and trying to find the best in what people do, I kind of get sort of hyper focused sometimes, because the vocals, you know, ideally the most important thing of a singer songwriter song, you know, it's a no brainer. But the control thing is weird. Like, you know, whenever I sing, I try and be intentional, but you can't just manifest it or tense up too much. You kind of got to relax. But even when I'm tapping my toes, you know, to the you know, rhythm of the song while I'm playing guitar or on stage, if I shake my body too much, my pitch, it'll like create a different kind of vibrato in my in
That's
whatever
interesting.
tone. And maybe, you know, sort of like maybe self-conscious of like maybe pushing pitch a little sharp or flat sometimes. So how somebody can drum and physically move their body and still hold a note. Yeah, I don't know how they do it.
Yeah, incredible. Incredible. Great song. And and lyrics are kind of interesting too. I really enjoy this. I know her girl named Sue showed me her tattoo. Do we know a Sue, or is that just like this is just, you know, it's
You
convenient,
know,
easy to rhyme?
well, it's I won't say it's like, you know, William Shakespeare. There's deeper songs. But I think the idea of this record is not to be too precious, you know. There's so many great people writing intentionally like masterful songs or going for that, you know.
Yeah.
But I just wanted to make a record with my band and make a rock record that felt good. And to me, like, everything on the record has a flow to it, and there's a relaxed vibe to it, and the songs are simple. You know, my favorite writing, personally, that I try and do emulates folks like J.J. Cale or even Merle Haggard in the distilled simplicity of it. That's what I love about the writing process, is finding that simple message, and then and not over singing, not overplaying, you know. There's moments to shine, moments to be to be have hot licks or whatever in there, but just the relaxing into it and letting the band cruise and sound like a unit and play well together. That's what really I think this record, if it has, if that's one of the strengths of it, is that just that gelling, relaxed thing about it. It's the rock record, I think, but I don't know that it's, some people could put roots rock or still have the country thing in it. You know, there's no escaping that little color that kind of makes it that to some degree. But yeah, it's a blast to write songs. But yeah, it's no William Shakespeare, but it has a vibe and a feel, and an attitude, I think. And I think that was kind of the main thrust of that song, and a few other others on the record. Like I said, I'm not trying to be a Bob Dylan with my writing on this one.
Yeah, and you shouldn't. And variety is always the spice. And let Bob Dylan be closer to
Yeah.
Shakespeare, and you could have fun. And it's been around for many decades now, the whole genre. You got great guitar solos throughout this project, which reminds me that. How do you come up with that? Like in Rather Be Right. I love the song too.
Oh
It's
yeah.
kind of has that comical edge to it too.
Yeah.
Great, great guitar solo.
Oh, thanks, man. Well, I love rock guitar, I love country guitar, but there's a couple players that really kind of like inspired me through the years. Pete Anderson, who played with Dwight Yoakam for many, many years, was a guy who would get right on the edge of falling off a cliff, like making a tragic mistake. But then the power of that is he would get real wacky and then pull it back in right on the cusp of like disaster. And so that always made it interesting to hear that player. And just before I got on the call with you today, I was listening to a guitar player named Danny Gatton, who's I had the Hot Licks video, like, as a guitar player, like, when you're young, like I would get the VHS tapes of like, oh, the Eric Johnson, how to play that lick. Well, Danny Gatton had one, and from that video and listening to his records, I picked up what I could sort of translate. He's an incredible genius, like way beyond, most any mortal human being. But there are attitudes and like sort of like I said, that pushing that limit, that I tried to pick up from Danny Gatton's playing. And it was great watching those videos because it reminded me of like, oh, I do that. Oh yeah, that's kind of. I still do that I learned from that Danny Gatton video, and also thanks to Hot Licks videos for some attitude on that solo particularly.
Yeah. And just like some of these lyrics, I'd rather be right. It's like, is that a character or is it just a melange of characters
Well,
that you go
that one
into?
is I will say I wrote that with my buddy Cary Ott, and we did have someone in mind that we were kind of calling out a little bit, and but yeah, I mean, we all know those people there. We were talking the other day. I wanted to do that. That's the one. That's the song. Rather Be Right was a song I was trying to do a video for, and it has that character in it that's sort of like,
Right.
maybe needs a little advice on their attitude, how they're approaching the world, and the video failed because I didn't really have a character in it. It was
Yeah,
really
yeah.
kind of ambient footage, and it needed that kind of like reference point. And I couldn't get the right footage together to do it. I didn't want to subject any of my friends to be that guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Can you act in?
Yeah.
I didn't want to put a label on that person and say, hey, this, can you be a horrible human being for a minute?
Right. It either goes one of the other ways. Either you get an actor to do that and you kind of do a concept video, or you just simply do a straight on performance video and let people do the
Yeah.
visuals.
Yeah. But the only alternative I came up with is here in the studio, I happen to have a bunch of tchotchkes, of junk around the house, but I have a Mexican wrestler's mask. And I was like, oh, maybe if we make this character ambiguous, we don't have to like embarrass anybody. They could just be a stand-in, like Strong Bad or whatever.
We all know people like that, and people like that, they would argue with a fence post. It's just, I know so many, especially being in media and doing this as long as I have. You just got these characters. It's like, I don't know how you could have this kind of, I guess it's somewhat of a narcissistic attitude too. It's kind of part of that. It's like they just, know-it-alls everywhere, and they've just got to get that last word.
Yeah, that's the truth. Like you said, I mean, in maybe it's most industries. I don't know. Maybe there's lonely jobs that people don't have to deal with humanity's ups and downs. But yeah, in music, there's a lot of egotism and narcissism and self sort of self harm. I don't know. It's something that everybody deals with. We all have fragile egos, you know. I remember just recently, this last year, a buddy of mine called me, and he was really bummed that he had played on a record, and nobody was dismissive of his parts, but he wound up, another guitar player came in and played on the record, and my friend was just destroyed about it. And I was like, oh, I'll be your wise friend. I'll give you a little advice. Oh, don't worry, man. This has happened to you. This has happened to me. It happens to everybody. It's no big deal. Here I am, this wise guy. And then like 3 weeks later, I had a similar thing where I was just crushed. I was just destroyed by my little fragile ego being like, exploded for that day. But perspective and all that is really tough. But try and do the best you can.
How did you learn how to play all these instruments? Did it start with a guitar, moving into piano? How did all that come about as you were growing up?
My folks were so sweet. They're such supportive parents. Neither played an instrument growing up, but they knew I loved it and had a real excitement about it. So I had guitar lessons from a great teacher for 4 years, who I just reconnected with, which is so exciting to reconnect with this guy who taught me guitar when I was 10 to 14. Like, really excited. He's in Knoxville and still playing and still sounding great. So I'm excited to catch up with him. And then another great guitar teacher, a guy, a man named Randy Googe at Tennessee Tech, and he taught me guitar lessons for about another 3 or 4 years. Wonderful teacher. So I had these teachers that leaned into, I played mostly by ear as a young person. I didn't never really got the discipline to sight read, but doing that lesson foundation gave me this really fundamental working class capability on guitar. So when I came to town, I could start to hang, start to play, and not only play with other people, but have the sort of knowledge to write songs. I knew where things could go in at least fundamental form. So yeah, the guitar just was so fascinating to me. It still is exciting, and I love that energy. But just like picking up guitar for the first time when I was a kid, when I started playing other instruments, I would get that excitement and start to really dig in and obsess a little while, you get down a rabbit hole of like, oh man, the mandolin, I want to really sharpen what I got. So I go down that rabbit hole. So it's sort of like a hobby. Some people, play Dungeons and Dragons, and I pick up the whatever instrument I'm trying. I'm still trying to play pedal steel. I've recorded it somewhat on different projects. I've made up some solo records and things like that and played on records. But playing live with pedal steel is so incredibly intimidating because there's so much room for error, and it's like a fiddle in a way. I've never tried fiddle because that's an instrument that, like, if you're bad, you're bad.
Yeah, can be
Unforgiving.
tough.
But yeah, all these instruments are just kind of offshoots of being excited about music and wanting to hear different sounds. I'm not a big hot lick guy. I don't like to play a ton of notes or be super shreddy, but producing and recording other people and with my band, sometimes it's not just a new lick or a new riff or something like that. It's about what can you do with that tone shape? Can you double it or harmonize it? Simple lines, simple melody lines, singable things, And so having a facility on different instruments has given me this chance to have this palette. Here at the studio, I've got a bunch of guitars and instruments, and that's just an expression of like, hey, I want to have these tools at hand. I can grab and play. And if I have an idea for a certain sound, I can find it. It's in my library, so to speak.
Cool. And the band's name is obviously a takeoff of your last name. So did that just hit you one day? It's like, wow, this is kind of
Oh man, it's, you know, I think everybody who ever starts a band years later is like, ah, we should have named it something different.
Yeah.
But it's been great all these years. It's again, it's that introvert in me. It's like I wouldn't call it Dave Coleman, but I can call
Yeah.
it thinly veiled guise of Dave Coleman, you know. But yeah, I don't know. It's there's a little bit of connection with at Big South Fork where I grew, or close to where I grew up, there was a historical mining company called the Stearns Mining Company, and so we spent a lot of time up around Big South Fork, and so I kind of felt like it was a good tie-in. And my album collection when I was a late teenager into my 20s was just this big gamut of roots rock and roll. You know, I loved everything about where I grew up, ironically, because when I grew up there, I wanted to leave. But
Who
ain't that the
doesn't?
way?
It's always the story, right? No matter where you're from, it's like, yeah, I gotta get out of this place. I was that way about Cleveland. You know,
Yeah.
and the similarities were, yeah, if you're not really into sports, yeah, there were people like, hey man, I've got to be in a band. And there were some big people who came out of there.
Oh
Just
man.
like, yeah, absolutely.
There's a guitar player here in town that this guy named Jack Silverman, and he's a Cleveland guy. And man, Jack took that route, man. He played so much in Cleveland and was a big part of that scene, but he came down to Nashville and super expressive. You know, he found his home here and he's on fire and making great music all the time. So, you know, Cleveland's got a great history though. When we were two or through there, we would go by the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and of course we're a small band traveling through, but they would let us in if we just brought them our latest record,
Oh, cool.
free of charge. They
Nice.
just, you know, and I thought to myself, man, in Nashville, the Country Music Hall of Fame could never do that because there's so many bands.
Yeah.
Yeah,
All over that place. Yeah. Every
yeah.
corner, there's a band.
But yeah, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, man, and just lots of great times going up there and traveling through.
Yeah. It's always based on their environment there. And I remember it's that blue collar feeling. There's a lot to tap into there, just like Springsteen did up in New Jersey. There's just so much, you know, just really being empathetic with the struggles of the everyday common person there. So just, yeah, just
Yeah.
totally amazing. But this new record is great. And you recorded not everything. How did you put it together? Was it all done by file? A lot of people I've talked with over through the pandemic, it's like, yeah, I sent this file over here and then I sent this to my mixer and it all came together here. Everything was done just so virtually through all this technology.
Yeah, that's been a tool I've had to utilize a lot with other work, but this most recent record was all done here. Here in the studio, we got together and recorded everything here. The last record pushed the sides in what you were that method you were talking about. We recorded those basic tracks actually in Key West. A great
Oh,
friend of mine,
cool.
Lance Taylor, has a studio down there, and we recorded the basic tracks down there. He sent those files to me, and I did the overdubs here, and then mixed it. And then a wonderful mastering engineer named Alex McCullough mastered it, who's done work, who's helped me all these years. But yeah, this one was done all here, and it was great to sort of own it. I've recorded so many other bands and other artists all here, but this is actually I think the first record where from start to finish, even I think all the songs were written down here too. So it's kind of comes from this little humble studio on Howard Avenue. So
There's a little history there with that in Nashville in that area. So that's just always interesting. But whoever would have thought, you know, decades ago, you'd be able to do this from your house. You know, you
yeah.
used to have to go to a studio, big old tape machines. It was
Yeah.
just such a hassle, I'm sure.
Well,
You know,
it's the dream for sure to have
yeah.
all this. Any or a lot of musicians would get a four track home studio back in the 80s or late 80s or 90s, and Tascam made them, and we would even set up, we would record on one boom box and then play it into another boom box and play along to get our overdub, and then do it again and again. And you know, that's multi-tracking like that was, it was kind of, that's how I first figured out how to do it. But yeah, to have all this ability at home without having to get like a, you know, beg for some sort of loan, you know, or you know, have a credit card debt for years, building this here at the home, at this house, and having this chance to record from home. Incredible. Yeah, it's living beyond the dream when I was a kid. I actually came, a little side story, I came across a high school thing, a little English assignment that they made us do about your life goals when you were in high school as a
Oh.
freshman, you know. And my mom was getting rid of all this stuff, so I you know, I grabbed it, I took a read through it, and I was like, oh my God, I've done everything I wanted to do when I was a kid. Like,
Yeah.
so now everything on top of this, like I feel like I won, man. Like,
Yeah. It's like, what is it, that 10,000 hours they talk about, like that you put into it, and that's how
yeah.
you could master your career, your dreams. So all from Englewood. Is now that is that a, that's a neighborhood in
It's a
within
neighborhood.
Nashville?
Yeah. We're so, Nashville's, I mean, Atlanta's got so many neighborhoods and pockets and
Right.
different vibes. And so, we're just really proud of this street. Like I said, we moved here. I've lived over in East Nashville since about 2001, since I got out of college. Really identified with this, our really creative scene. But when we moved over here, I used to live one street over, like at the same number, about 15 years ago, and then we bought this house, and we just identify with this place. Our neighbors are amazing, and we love this little pocket, and so that's why I say Englewood. I'm just going to kind of want to name check our little neighborhood that we love
Yeah.
so much.
Yeah, you're not too far to the Cumberland River. It's a,
No, yeah,
this is
about
a
3 miles.
beautiful town. Oh,
Yeah,
yeah.
yeah.
Love that Tennessee River in Nashville. Just they've done so much there. It's just a great place. So, I mean, the CVB, I'm doing the work for your wife there.
Yeah, right
The
on, right on. Sell it.
CV.
Sell it to
Come on up. I really like to do one of their marathon, half marathon. I think it's
you. Yeah.
rock and roll, but
Yeah, that rock and roll country music half marathon's great. And there's a couple different races that I've done through the year. There's one called the Flying Monkey that's
never
at
heard of that.
Percy Warner's, which is beautiful, beautiful park. Yeah, there's lots of great races. So yeah, come to town and do a race. It's so good.
Yeah, I've only passed through on the way to Louisville more recently. I was in Nashville. I spent more time there many, many decades ago. But yeah, they have a song called Love This Town. Is this referring to just your passion for it?
I wrote that with my friend Mark Winchester, who's an incredible bass player and has a wonderful project called Sizzle Went to VCR. But he's such a witty dude and so smart. And has lived here even longer than I have. I think he moved to town in the 80s, but he and I wrote, just we started just expressing that idea of how much it's changed, and a little bit of snarkiness about it, you know. I say I just got through telling you all this, you know. I don't want to be nostalgic, and here I am. Oh, maybe I was being a little nostalgic, you know. So,
That's music,
it's
right?
complicated. I'm a complicated human being.
And speaking of being nostalgic, you're nostalgic for Joe Strummer. That must have hit you one night, like,
Oh yeah.
damn, I miss this guy.
Well, yeah, there's that song I wrote with my buddy Jamie Rubin, who's I used to play every Tuesday night with his band called the Carpetbaggers Local 615 at this killer club called the Family Wash. And the Family Wash had gone through two iterations at two different places, and Jamie's now got this incredible venture called the East Side Bowl, which is a wonderful venue and bowling alley now. But the Family Wash, we played all the time, and Jamie and I wrote this song about Joe Strummer. And yeah, just one of those heroes, you know. He's almost like a you know, he's like a he's a leader, you know. I mean, like somebody
Yeah.
who could teach not just through music, but through action and bring some political awareness to things, which is, a little dicey sometimes with musicians. People sometimes don't react well to that, but Joe did it kind of loud and proud, and maybe he's that extrovert that I kind of wish I was on, on some level.
Yeah, it's really tough because you don't want to alienate audiences. We're so polarized. So that's, some probably best is for most musicians to kind of stay away from that, especially, I even the legacy acts. I mean, some can get away with it, but, I see comments online, you Springsteen, you suck. It's like, what? You haven't written a good song in 50 years. You really suck. It's like, come on.
Yeah, well, I think there's great ways to do it, to be subtle about it, and everybody's got their opinions, and if you're making the art, say what you want to say. I always encourage other bands and artists who come to town to really just embrace who they are. Don't try and chase anybody. Like, be as weird as you possibly can be. Be as much of you as you can possibly be. Because if you try and chase somebody else, it's been done,
Right.
really well. Not to say we're not this, big, stew of whatever influences we've got going on. But yeah, be as weird as you can be. But yeah, the subtle ways of being political or expressing what you really care about, maybe that's what I try and lean into a little bit.
Yeah. And they always say, or they're the experts, you always do better, being live. So are you performing quite a bit? Are you touring a lot more these days?
We're doing a lot of stuff here in Nashville, and we've got some trips planned to Florida. The band used to tour a lot up the East Coast through up through East Tennessee and Virginia and North Carolina, DC and New York, Philly, and those places, and a fair amount up in the Midwest and stuff too. But right now, we're not going to be traveling a lot. What we'll do is play mostly here in town, and the great thing about those Florida shows all these years is it's afforded us the chance to meet people from all over the country, all over the world, really, that would come down there and play. It was almost like having a cruise ship gig. You meet all these people from all around the world, and not that I don't love traveling and seeing other towns, but we've done that so much through the years. After all these years, I think it's a good time for us to be creative and release stuff when the band wants to and when we feel inspired. And if we can keep this family thing together, I feel an obligation after 25 years. I'm like, we can't break up. We got to keep this thing going. But thankfully, the guys are really so into it and supportive, and it's been like a second family, like I said, to keep this thing going. But we'll do a little bit of traveling. There's some chances to get out and play. The industry changes so much. I have a degree from Belmont University in music business from 2001. The whole thing's changed. The whole thing's changed.
Entertainment all in general, and it's going through this what they call disruption. I don't know what that
Oh,
means, but
yeah.
it's a huge disruption. It's so changed. Yeah, and it really has. It's just because technology's gotten involved. Now we're entering into the age of AI. So, like, what's
Yeah.
that going to be all about?
Yeah. What it's going to be fascinating to see the pros and cons of that. I mean, I know at least in the technical side of recording music, I mean, technology is your friend. I mean, lean into it and be expressive with it. The Beatles would have used Pro Tools and Auto Tune all over the place if they had the ability. They totally would have done it. So use the tools at hand to be. To, maybe it just empowers creativity. That's my hope and positive spin on it. So.
Yeah, we hope so. That's it's just not going to replace. It's just going to enhance and improve. Yeah, Beatles have definitely proven that. And constantly, band's been gone well over more than half a century, and it just it keeps repeating, it keeps improving upon itself through
Yeah.
technology. It's really amazing.
It is funny. So recording a lot, I mentioned the auto-tune thing. And here's an odd observation. I've met a few young people who have grown up since the dawn of auto-tune and hearing it on pop records. And And I've met a few young people who sing as if they're auto-tuned.
Oh, wow.
Who
Didn't think
it's
about
subtle.
that.
It's subtle, but
Wow.
their note transitions from like little flips and stuff like that
Huh.
emulates naturally somehow, like a mockingbird would figure out how to do a certain melody. Like they're able to achieve this like almost auto-tuned sound. So that technology has become part of how people experience music in that to that generation or to those people. But it shows you, and man, I don't know. It's going to be here. People are just, or music's always changing and being influenced by the tools at hand, you know, reverb and echo, all like that wasn't a thing in the original days, and we all, you know, so many people use those tools now too.
Oh, that's really fascinating. That's a good story. So, how are you getting this out? Is this getting any radio play? You just counting on more streams through Spotify and services like that?
You know, I think the sort of idea is we've had a lot of a small core group of fans through the years who are aware of the band, and then helping get the songs out to sort of local radio and radio stations that we've been fans of and who followed us through the years. I don't have a massive budget for promoting the record. You know, we're very kind of DIYers. So my plan is just to really kind of push it out there as much as we can and see if friends can lean in and tell their friends about it. I mean, we have a wonderful publicist, Mike Farley, who we had worked with a long time ago helping out connect they connect or he connected us. So we'll do our best to kind of get these videos out there and get some streaming going on. And definitely there's been some great radio stations like WMOT here in Nashville and NCW out in North Carolina that we'll definitely make sure that they know about the record and hopefully play it. So
Yeah, sixth album. It was always Vascaladies Records, is that was always the label. Where does that name come from?
Oh man, there's the movie Office Space, if you're familiar with that movie.
Yes, yeah, I
Okay.
saw years ago.
Oh, it's a great comedy, but there's a character who's the neighbor, and what it comes from is that me and Dave and Hitch, when we started the band, we loved that movie. We all had temp jobs at the time, and we were kind of living like that. That movie told our life at that point. We were miserable at these day jobs, and but there's a character in the film who is the neighbor who is really kind of grumpy and sort of a hilarious character, but. There's a line that we misunderstood because I think he said a different town, but we thought he said Vascalitas, but the line was something like, "Yeah, I got to get up at oh dark 30 and do the drywall at the new McDonald's down in Vascalitas," and we laughed so much. Well, like that was just something we would say all the time, and like the tin can thing. I don't even think that he mentions. I think it was like Phoenix or something like that, but we heard that, and that became part of the. Part of our joke or inside joke, and so that's always been our little imprint. So
That's great. And you got some notice from Todd Snyder, one of the premier songwriters. That's fantastic. Yeah.
he's a wild guy, and but he's been really supportive through the years. We've done some touring with Todd, and I've done some recording with him, and worked on a handful of projects. He's an inspiring guy. Both musically and just a creative spirit, you know. He's a lifer, you know, like he's a lifer that'll, you know, has built a thing that's so admirable. He's a great storyteller. I typically when we play, I'll tell a few stories every now and then, but I love the power of the band. But he's one of those guys who can tell a great story and wrap people up in that. So
Sweet. Well, good deal. I really appreciate you stopping by, and
yeah,
new
man.
single
Thank you,
Black
Bob.
Cat is out.
Man, thank you so much for having us. And yeah, I hope people spread the word a little bit. We're just a little working class band, and we're keeping it going and making our little brand of music.
And we could find you online. What is the website? And then you're probably on all the streamers like Spotify, Amazon Music.
Yeah, thecoleman.com, the coal as you would burn in the stove, and men.com, all one word for the website. And then I'm on Instagram at the Dave Coleman. And then Facebook too. Yeah, that's basically kind of what we're doing. But yeah, all the Spotify stuff, you can check out years and years of different records and videos. It's been a lot of fun going through this and finding different ways to make music with these three guys. So.
Good deal. Take care. Best wishes.
Okay, thanks a million, Bob.
Have a good one. And that was really great. I really had a good time with Dave here. He just has a really wonderful album out. He's a great writer. He's like, yeah, I'm no Shakespeare. Who is? I mean, I wouldn't even go near any of that. Or a Bob Dylan. There's only one Bob Dylan out there. That is for sure. Thanks for hanging in with me throughout this entire episode. I hope you enjoyed it. Keep on listening. I have a great catalog of great interviews out there. TalesFromTheCorners.com or check out TFTC with Bob Niebel wherever you get your podcasts. I prefer Apple Podcasts, but check it out on Spotify, Amazon Music, or wherever you get them. Take care, folks. Have a good one.